Good evening and welcome. My name is Hawthorne Smith, and it is my distinct pleasure to invite you to commemorate and celebrate with us the Bellevue Program for Survivors of Torture, our 25th anniversary. It's going to be a very special night. We will be hearing from the founders of our program. We will be meeting some incredible survivors who will share some of their experiences with you. We will be discussing with some of the greatest legal minds here in New York City around some of the processes and challenges facing survivors and asylum seekers. There will be music, there will be poetry. There's a lot that's going on, but most importantly, it gives us a chance to connect with you. We've missed you. It feels so good to be with you, but let me step aside and let's get the program started so you can learn a little bit more about what we do.
I'm so happy you guys saved my life, because I was gonna kill myself. I don't wanna live no more. May you guys didn't let those happen.
Nous avons la même vision, qu'on nous dise un jour cette vérité, pourquoi on nous attend fait souffrir. Et c'est cette souffrance qu'on a vécue ensemble, hein, où on était tous destinés qu'à mourir.
They're using their guns and they're pointing it at me. And they're boom and they're firing it. Boom and they're firing it. They're literally pressing the trigger firing it, but with their mouth, you're like boom, you know? And I'll be like, to me it's real, because it's like I felt every boom, I felt every bullet to my soul.
Central to our mission of helping individuals rebuild their lives is also training individuals. We see individuals, for lack of a better way of saying it, who their lives have been trampled, and we get to see them and hopefully help them blossom again.
So who are the people that we're dealing with? Perhaps someone that's written a letter to the editor or blogged, someone who belongs to a political party and has voted in a particular way, someone who belongs to an identifiable religious group, someone who's been advocating for human rights, doing the same sort of things that we're doing here. Perhaps someone who is victimized purely because of the fact that they are a woman. Perhaps it's someone who has a sexual orientation that is other than heterosexual. Any or all of these issues can be what leads somebody here. These people are survivors. We are scratching the tip of the iceberg, which is the tip of the iceberg in terms of even those people who can make it here.
Thank you.
stand at an inflection point, proverbial crossroads. And when we think about the crossroads, we think of a place of peril and possibilities. We think of uncertainty, but we also think of magic. And the crossroads isn't something that is static. It's not a two-dimensional thing. It's multidimensional. We stand on the shoulders of those who have gone before us, people who have sacrificed and have made incredible efforts so that we have the opportunity to do what it is we do and to try to move forward, to create a world, a more just society for those who will follow. It's kind of like a vertical ascension. But there is also the horizontal plane, the fact that we share space, we share time, we share a moment in time, a particular time in history with those who are within our community. And this crossroads is very much a dynamic idea. It is not static. It is something we carry with us. It is the decisions we make. It's the actions that we take. So we will very much keep with this theme tonight. We will look back. We will speak, as I mentioned, with the founders of our program. We will pay homage to some of the people who really instilled our program with what it means. It gave us our very meaning, our essence. We will be speaking with legal experts who will help to detail the current challenges facing asylum seekers in what are very daunting circumstances right now. You will meet incredible survivors who, through their examples, through their stories, will help to hopefully open your eyes and hearts to what is going on in our community all over. So let's get started. And what I would like to do at this point is to introduce you to an incredible young woman who is largely responsible for the fact that our program has not only survived, but is trying to thrive during these turbulent times. And she is the driving force behind this virtual benefit. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Caroline Albans.
Each year, the Phoenix Award is given to PSOT clients who have dedicated themselves to defending human rights while facing their own personal trauma. I am honored to introduce tonight's first Phoenix Award recipient, Mr. Joseph Gueu.
My name is Joseph Gueu. I'm from Ivory Coast. I was born in a little city town that we call Danane in the west part of Ivory Coast. I was born in a family where we were a kind of a human rights activist. My mom was a very active human rights activist. She was fighting for little girls who were abused during the war. When I moved in Abidjan, I was a student activist on the campus because I realized that there was a lot of injustice. I have to decide with some of my friends to see how we can try to be in connection with the administration to establish a kind of equality that will allow everyone to take advantage of the resources we have on the campus. So when you come, they will always ask you, what is your ethnic group? They will tell you, tell me your name, I will tell you where you are from. My name is Gueu Joseph. Oh, you don't need to say where you are from. You are from West Side. So we were targeted like that. In 2005, we have a kind of civil war in the country. Our relationship between the administration and the student, I don't know how to say dégraté. I realized that my life was in danger because I was one of the leaders of those actions. They were looking for me everywhere. Most of my friends who were arrested at the time, I was not 100% sure where they were, in jail or somewhere else. We don't know if they die, we don't know if they kill them, we don't know where they are exactly. I consulted with my wife. I told her that I have this opportunity. Maybe I can go to Europe or I can go to the United States and see if the situation is getting much better, then I will come back. But if I stay here, maybe I will be arrested. The only flight we have was from Abidjan to JFK. So I took the flight. I know that I was flying to the United States, but I don't know exactly where I was going to stay if I get here. No family, no friends, no connection. So I took the risk. I remember it was on the 3rd December 2010. And one day I have a friend who came to visit me. He said, if you are here, you really need to talk to a physician, to meet a doctor. I said, but I don't have insurance. I don't know what to do. Where do you want me to go? I don't have money. He said, no, you don't need all those things. Go to Bellevue Hospital. There's a program there. They can take care of you. It was with Dr. Smith. I remember he came, he talked to me, and I was crying. He gave me a cup of water. He said, relax, brother. You are in your family. You will see a lot of people coming from different countries. You will share your story with them. And I was like, you don't know me. How you can give me such motivation? My first family in the United States. If there is one thing I will never forget being in the United States is the street from my house to the Federal Plaza. Because since 10 years, I've been going through the same street every day, every day, every day. I've been waiting since 10 years. And I will tell you that I've been before the immigration judge more than 17 times today, until today. My daughter is today 11 years old. I never seen her after I left the country physically. And it's still painful when you are away from your family, biological family, and you have to survive in someone else's country. I will never encourage anyone to go through what I've been through. It's hard. Being waiting for something for 10 years is not easy. But the fact that I have to survive, I have to resist, is because I have people like Dr. Smith, I have people like Mr. John, the staff at the Bellevue Program of Survival of Torture. When they look me, they give me motivation. When they give me a call, they ensure me that Joseph, tomorrow we will be much better. Every time I meet one of them, my day is highlighted. I'm always happy. Thank you for the award. I'm so happy to have this award. And I would like first to thank the Bellevue family. That's my real family. They gave me a lot of strength during this moment. And secondly, I would like to thank all my French-speaking friends who are with me at Bellevue Program of Survival of Tortures. And finally, I would like to think about my daughter who is back home in Ivory Coast, who I have never seen since 10 years. Thanks to everyone.
Hey, mon frère Joseph, félicitations. Can you imagine knowing a gentleman like this, knowing him as your client, knowing him as your friend, knowing him as a community member? Can you imagine having him as a father and what that would be like, his daily touch, his guidance? But to be denied that opportunity to have him present in your life like that for bureaucratic realities is a cruelty I have trouble wrapping my head around. But this incredible man somehow continues to move forward. He leads with his heart. And he's a leader within the community. When COVID first hit New York with all of its ferocity and we were scrambling to see how he would deliver virtual visits and telehealth, by the time we were able to sort of put things in place, this brother, Joseph, had already started what he called the virtual village. And the Francophone African Survivors group that we've been running now for 24 years was up and running again because of his leadership and his guidance. So when I think about his story, when I think about the paradox of the life of a survivor, when I think about the resilience and I think about the fragility, when I think about the despair and the hope, when I think about the nostalgia and longing, but also the forward-facing advancement and the real optimism, I try to put these things together, but words fail me. I don't think it can be done with prose. But fortunately, we have very, very talented friends and family members in our community. And coming next is an award-winning poet, an internationally acclaimed novelist. She was here as a psychology intern and now is out in the community providing services for marginalized people. To bless us with some of her words is Dr. Hala Alian.
Hi, my name is Hala Alian, and this is called How to Survive Your Body. One, turn it into a house. Meet yourself at the door, say welcome. Say, I'm sorry I haven't vacuumed for a while. The summer was rough, but there are love letters under the floorboards and enough rooms in this body for all of us. Two, turn it into a bottle. Become addicted to your own heartbeat and then bless the mother that made it. Bless the rain frizzing your hair. Bless the womb that twice now hasn't gotten it right. Bless what sheds and dies and returns. Three, make it into a garden. Remember seasons, remember harvest, remember that to love the orchid, you must first love the monsoon. It can't always be April, and a thing doesn't have to feel good to be saving your life like your heart. Beating furiously is just a seedling trying to break soil. Let it panic. It knows what it's doing. It has seen you through gunfire and evacuation ships, through four coastlines and three broken loves. This heart has walked you through wars. You can forgive it a little shakiness for. Hold your body like an animal more used to kick than love. When your friend says, us daughters of refugees, we've got that fight or flight in our blood, say yes. Say 1948, say Thawra, say passport, say 1990, say I remember the road from Baghdad to Damascus and we left my father behind. Say I've been memory since, say I've been running since, say I learned at the knee of colonizers. Know the word for nostalgia in French before I know it in Arabic. Know how to erase myself out of a textbook, say a person can't inherit a world on fire and not grow to practice arson on herself. Five. Turn your body into a language and forget it. Turn it into an arrow and take aim. Listen to your mother. You can take panic and birth a daughter from it. You can take a daughter and birth land from her. It's coded in your DNA. You have your uncle's eyes, your grandmother's heart. Hate this body all you want, but it is still the best living artifact of your ancestors. Every heave of your lungs, every sob is a goddamn miracle, you daughter of your baba, of your mama, you daughter of refugees, you refuge. Every breath is a revolution, is a flag put back together from ash, is a way of keeping Palestine alive, and Damascus, and Akka, and you say you don't believe in borders, so why are you still cutting yourself up like this? Six, turn your body into a country and reclaim it. Turn it into God and surrender. Straighten your back, lift your chin, dread the morning and greet it anyway. Do it for your grandmother. Do it for the daughter who may or may not come, who you may or may not name after map or desert flower or Arab night. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah and you are museum, monument to everything you have survived. You are resurrected. You are uncle's eyes and Palestine's voice and grandmother's heart, and there is enough history, enough memory, enough rooms in this body for all of us.
Hi there.
Hey, Kate, Dr. Porterfield, long time.
Hi, Dr. Yinka. It's so good to see you. I miss you.
Ditto, ditto. Hi, I'm Yinka Kinchlores-Smith, senior staff psychologist here at the Program for Survivors of Torture.
And I'm Kate Porterfield, a psychologist at Program for Survivors of Torture. And we're here today briefly just to ask you to support our incredible program and our Survivors Fund.
Tonight, our goal is to raise $25,000 and it's easy for you to do. Donate tonight.
So each year, just to give you a little background, the Survivor Fund provides invaluable support for the Program for Survivors of Torture's operations and clients. But this year, we need it more than ever. COVID-19 hit our clients particularly hard. Many of them were on the front lines of this crisis in New York, providing care to the elderly, to children, driving Ubers, cooking, delivering food, deep cleaning people's homes, working in medical centers. You know, Yinka, I'm sure you remember that as it was hitting the COVID crisis in New York, we did what we do pretty well at PSOT, which is we like circled up and we said, okay, what do we need to do? We need to reach out to our clients, let them know protocols here, let them know what to do if they need something. But of course, what for me was the most touching and the thing I love about our place is that we also said, yeah, but we got to call old clients too. Everybody, just see where folks are. Does anybody need anything? And so we all got out our lists and our phones, and I was texting folks I hadn't talked to in 10 years, literally, just for people to know we have their backs, just we care about you calls. How are you? Do you need anything? And amazingly, you know, most of our calls, I think in that experience were calls where people were like, I'm good, take care of people there, you know, like just feeling the resilience of our clients who have been through, you know, our program, citizenship, asylum. So it was a really touching time. And I'll just tell you one quick story was there was a client who is driving an Uber. And I called and was just touching base. And he said, well, I need to just talk to you about my plastic. Like, what kind of plastic do you think I should put up between the front and the back? Like, don't you think plastic's a good idea during this? And I said, okay, well, let's figure this out. And we're looking at plastic. And I said, you know, when I got my psychology degree, I did not learn about like plastics and like where to, you know, prevent diseases from spreading in cars, but let's do this, you know, let's figure it out. And that is the spirit of PSOT. That's the way we work with our clients. And our Survivor Fund is what helps us do that. It helps us help our clients with their real day-to-day lives.
But this is exactly the point, Kate. It's the small things, the small needs that we're able to step in with. So I just think, as you were mentioning, calling our clients and the isolation that's gone on, many of our clients' phones are key. I had clients whose phones suddenly were not working because they could not pay their fees. So I couldn't reach them and they couldn't reach me. But through the Survivor Fund, we were able to pay for their phone bills, to keep them connected, to decrease their sense of isolation. You know, right. During these summer months that were so hot, when we were locked inside our homes, clients who had no air conditioning, through the Survivor Fund, we were able to help them small ways to maintain dignity in their lives. So friends out there, with your help, PSOT provided micro grants to individuals and families who were excluded from unemployment and stimulus payments from the government. Since mid-March, we have given over $15,000 to over 125 individuals and families. This money goes directly to impact the lives of our clients.
We are so lucky to be able to support our clients through the Survivor Fund as its own specific way that we support. We need your help, though, to make sure we can do it. So whether this is like buying Metro cards for folks to get to their appointments, getting plane tickets for people to bring family from other countries, each dollar you give will impact someone's real life. So today, I want you to, right now, if you have already given, thank you so much, pick up your phone, text 5 friends and say, hey, check out this website, the PSOT, survivorsoftorture.org. Give them a little money. You will help the greatest, most resilient New Yorkers, our clients who come and build their lives to be part of our community. So this is a concrete, direct way to help. We know folks are looking for that these days with so much difficulty in the world. Please contribute and help us here at PSOT and help our wonderful, wonderful clients.
It is very easy. Please just go to the link in the description below. Thank you.
See you all soon. Be safe.
Good evening. My name is John Wilkinson, and I've had the honor of working as the Director of Legal Services here at the Bellevue Program for Survivors of Torture for the past 20 years. I thank you all for joining us on this special night to support our program and our amazing clients. This morning, I had the honor of representing one of our clients for his naturalization interview. We did our final preparation for the interview over the past two nights, and I'm happy to say that he aced it this morning. So in just a few months, he will be a new US citizen. I still remember how happy all of us in the program were when this gentleman won his asylum case about 7 years ago. One should remember that the path to asylum is often a long and painful road. When we collaborate with law firms to assist our clients, it is a shared commitment to a process that may take years. Client needs and circumstances frequently change, but these dedicated legal service providers support them every step of the way. Tonight, we honor three of PSOT's longest standing legal partners with the Steve Kolleeny Pro Bono Service Award. The firms represented here this evening have been instrumental in the success of countless PSOT clients in their pursuit of asylum. We are doubly grateful that representatives from each of these esteemed firms have agreed to talk with us about some of the challenges and recent changes in the asylum process that are causing so much pain for survivors seeking refuge in the United States. So please join me in welcoming Chulai Chung from Davis Polk and Wardwell, Holly Henderson Fisher from Skadden Arps, and Anwen Hughes from Human Rights First. So my first question is to Chulai Chung from Davis Polk. In your representation of asylum seekers, have you ever received assistance from PSOT? And if so, what kind of assistance, and was it helpful?
Thanks, John. And thank you, PSOT team. I know we at Davis Polk are really honored to receive this award. And to answer your question, yes, PSOT has been incredibly helpful in my and Davis Polk's work with asylum seekers. Our job as lawyers is to help our clients present their stories in a way that demonstrates that they qualify for asylum and that they merit that discretionary relief. But in order to do that, our clients have to be able to talk about what happened to them and, you know, ideally do so in a way that doesn't add further trauma to their current state, their current lives. And for some clients, that's an extremely difficult thing to do. So remember, these are some of the worst things that our clients have ever lived through, and we're asking them to explain it to us and to tell us, you know, again and again. You know, as lawyers, like, we're not really trained to be able to offer them the kind of like mental health care and the kind of mental health support that they need and that they really deserve. And that's where PSOT really steps in and really shines. For example, I had a client who managed to escape torture at the hands of the government in his home country. And for, you know, his family's safety, he had to lead them to believe that he had, in fact, been murdered in prison by the government. And so, you know, we've all talked about how long asylum the process can take. And, you know, his took over 7 years. And over the course of those 7 years, he couldn't speak to his family. And he was really alone, and that was extremely difficult for him. Most people who experience trauma can rely on loved ones or, you know, friends for support, but that just really wasn't an option that was available to him. And at points, like during the application process, he became really despondent and had suicidal idealizations, and, you know, at points in time threatened to jump from the Brooklyn Bridge and threatened to jump onto the subway tracks. And there were times where, you know, I as a lawyer don't really have the training to talk someone through that kind of crisis, but Hawk and the PSOT team like really, you know, really stepped in and helped basically talk him out of taking his own life. And, you know, thankfully this client has gotten asylum and is on the pathway to citizenship, but I'm just really not sure that he would have made it here without PSOT's work. It made a huge difference. And, you know, I'm really lucky as a lawyer to be able to, you know, have worked with PSOT through all of this and to help this client get asylum.
Oh, thank you so much. Our second honoree, Holly Henderson Fisher. The current administration has made many hostile changes to asylum policies over the past 4 years, such as the first in, last out policy. How has this affected the way that you work on asylum cases, and how has this affected your clients?
Well, thank you, John. I also first want to thank the Program for Survivors of Torture for bestowing this award upon Skadden. I know that all of Skadden joins me in agreeing that this is one of the most special awards that we could win. The Steve Kolleeny Pro Bono Award is named after a former special counsel at Skadden who passed away. He was a pioneer in this field, and this award is a testament to his life and legacy, and also to the power of the practice of law. So we thank you for bestowing it upon us. To return to your question, though, I think over the last 4 years, we have sort of witnessed an unprecedented assault on non-citizens and immigrants and asylum policy in the United States. Some of these have been very visual and borne out in front of us, the child and family separation cases, the Muslim travel ban, the Remain in Mexico policy, but there are several, such as the one that you mentioned, the first in, last out, that are much more insidious, and the effects are incredibly harmful and have played out across the practice of law in this area for those of us at Skadden, and I'm sure other firms and organizations representing PSOT clients. Before this administration took office, asylum claims were processed as you would expect, as they came in, first come, first serve. Not anymore. Now the first in, the ones that have been waiting for years, are last out. They are waiting in a sort of interminable process, with the clients not knowing when they can expect to have their asylum applications adjudicated. This type of sort of nefarious policy really has sort of two goals. Some of them are easily identified, preventing asylum seekers from gaining enough time to apply for work authorization, but some are much more hidden. And that is the goal of breaking the spirit of someone who has been waiting for years for shelter from persecution that they've been suffering. And that is where the Program for Survivors of Torture is so invaluable, so vital. When the purpose of a policy is despair and to break spirit and to demoralize and really to cause a person to lose hope and lose faith, you need a bridge to see the end of that path. And that is what the Program for Survivors of Torture does. It allows a bridge between the legal representation and the client and a way to sort of work through what used to be a 3, 4, 5 month process, which is now a 5, 6, 7 year process. The effects of this type of policy, I should add, have real effects on people's lives. We have clients from your program who have been separated from their spouses and their children for years. We have a client who had a child who died at the hands of an unconscionable regime while waiting, all because the family could not be reunited until the asylum application was processed. This is a sort of shocking disregard for humanity, and we are living through it. But the Program for Survivors of Torture has made the legal fight remain possible, has kept hope alive for clients, has helped clients recognize their trauma, name their trauma, and rise up from their trauma. And that is why Skadden is so grateful for this organization. You are an unparalleled force for good in this field, and we are very lucky to be partnering with you.
Thank you so much. Our third honoree, Anwen Hughes. Our question is, the legal process for asylum seekers is more draconian than it's been in recent history. I think a lot of people are pessimistic about how our country moves forward from here. How do you envision the path forward?
Well, I think echoing what Holly was saying a moment ago, I think we are, you know, this has not been a good few years. And we have been dealing with a number of challenges. On the one hand, substantive ones, so attempts by this administration to undermine the substantive protections of asylum and make as few people as possible eligible for those protections, which has posed enormous challenges for our clients. And at the same time, a sort of scorched earth approach to the general functionality of the system, which has inflated backlogs that were already problematic in and of themselves, and seems to be aimed at making the system unworkable even for any other future administration that might take over, and then using that unworkability to say, you see, we can't give protection to people because the system is unworkable. So it's a nice circular approach. And the question is where we go. And, you know, I think Human Rights First, which I work for, has been very lucky in having a long partnership of many years with PSOT on advocacy, as well as on the representation of individual clients. And we're so honored to be getting this award. We're so grateful for the opportunity to collaborate with all of you in both of those areas. And we are right now, I think, like most of the public and like most of the clients we serve, oscillating between terror and hope, in a sense, and hoping that in a better scenario, this might be an opportunity to rebuild this system better. You know, I think that this has been a bit of a hurricane, a really large Category 5 storm for refugee lawyers and for the clients that we serve. And as we sift through the debris, I think our goal is to try to create a system that does work better. You know, the backlogs, which everyone has been commenting on, you know, I think on the one hand, we can all understand the desire to try to keep some proportion of cases, as many of them as possible, get those processed in a timely fashion. So these were the more recently filed ones. Sorry, I seem to have muted myself. I'm terribly sorry. I don't know how that happened. We're hoping to see a system that reverts to a understanding of the substance of refugee law, and at the same time allows asylum seekers to get a meaningful hearing at a meaningful time, so that those who qualify for relief can start moving, putting their lives back on track. Because I think one of the things that we all realize in doing this work is that for many of our clients, getting asylum is only the first step in their priorities, and that reuniting with their loved ones is, in many cases, a higher priority even than that. But that, you know, the protections of asylum, the way the Refugee Convention envisioned them, did not simply include a protection from physical or psychological persecution. They also included putting people on a path to a new life, to integration in a new community. And none of that can start in any meaningful sense, with any meaningful sense of security, until people actually get the relief of asylum and then have some realistic expectation that their later processes will be processed in a timely way. And so I think we're all acutely aware of this, the ways that our clients right now are suffering from high levels of anxiety. I've been hearing a lot of pretty specific concerns about people's physical safety in recent weeks and months. And as Chulai was commenting, we're all putting them through a process that inherently makes them relive their worst experiences that they had before coming to the United States. And so in doing all of that, we are so grateful that PSOT has remained with us through the ages and that we're able to use you to get our clients the support that they need.
Thank you so much, Anwen. And I just want to say congratulations again to all of our honorees. Thank you so much for participating in this panel, and thank you so much for all the help you've given to our clients. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The essence of who our program is to help individuals from around the world, usually refugees and asylum seekers, who've been brutally traumatized, treated in like the most awful, inhumane ways. And what we try to do and have done is to help these individuals to rebuild their lives.
The goal of what we do here is to have people make peace with their past, to be able to function well in the present, and to become again productive members of society, to be able to live their lives better for them, for their families, and for the future generations.
What we all realized at the same time was that not only were these individuals that we hoped and believed needed care, not only were they in need of just all sorts of services, but they really were in need of interdisciplinary care. We're individuals from different groups, different, you know, professions. We're working together, collaborating together, and really, you know, tying things together in a way that is so much greater than the parts. We realized we needed to address the physical, but hand in hand with the mental health. And then the social. What's the purpose of addressing somebody's broken bones or their depression or reactions to trauma if they don't have a safe place?
My perspective as a psychiatrist always came from relieving the emotional suffering of people that have gone through or medical illness or trauma. The challenge in psychiatry and in mental health in general, that most of these scars are invisible. Invisible scars are very hard to for people to grasp or to even understand.
Often, the individuals we cared for had been very successful in their country. They'd been lawyers, students, health professionals. I mean, a myriad of things. We had plenty of individuals who their only crime was attending a peaceful rally. We do our best to address the physical, emotional, social needs, literally from the moment they walk into our office. We try. Then they often overcome this huge obstacle, asylum. It really is a matter of life or death whether they're allowed to stay here, and we do our best to help support that. We made sure that if they were applying for asylum and they didn't have a lawyer, that we got them one. Well, there are many wonderful organizations we've worked with. One in particular, Human Rights First, who provide free legal services to so many of our patients. And that legal assistance, that's a treatment in and of itself.
If a patient is separated from their family and they've not seen their children in 4 or 5 years, or they're worried for their well-being, there's no medications that is going to fix that.
And then to actually be reunited with their family. And sometimes that's like 5, 10 years later, and what a gift. I would say several times a month, a client in our program will have been reunited with their family, and they will bring them to meet their PSOT family, which I think is just one of the, you know, most wonderful honors.
Many of our patients have graduated through schools, they've gotten very good jobs. The majority have actually managed their symptoms better, and they found new meaning in their lives that would have been impossible without the treatment that they received at the program.
That is wonderful, seeing how our patients go on to rebuild their lives. What really keeps me up at night is thinking about the people waiting for our care, because I know what we could do. From the moment our program began, we had a waiting list, and we really need your help. Believe me, private donations have been a lifeblood to this program. There really were times we would have closed if not for the generosity of our supporters. But it also teaches me each and every day of just the incredible resilience of the human spirit. It's in that spirit that we'll keep showing up to work. I hope many of you listening to keep helping us and to help the next and the next individual after that who walks through our door. Thank you.
It is with great esteem and appreciation that I'm able to introduce to you Miss Amal Nugd. I've been working with Miss Amal almost since she arrived to the United States as a traumatized refugee from the Sudan. From the very beginning, I was impressed by her life experience, her trauma, her personality, and how she carried herself with dignity despite the obvious signs of emotional suffering. As she tells her story, you are going to be able to observe how she describes her transformation from a woman of stature in the Sudan, fighting and advocating for women's rights and equality, working with international organizations like UNESCO, and traveling the world for that cause, to a traumatized refugee in the US, uprooted from her country, culture, language, and separated from her family. Furthermore, her transformation in the United States, with the support of our program, becoming fearless, confident woman who has been able to deal with adversity and has become a model to other women and other patients, showing resilience, pride, and reconnecting her humanity to others and to the cause of equality for women. Thank you. This is Miss Amal Nugd.
طبعا انا امال نجد من جمهوريه السودان الديمقراطيه. رحت من السودان للولايات المتحده الامريكيه في 7/3/2015 طالبه للجوء من الظروف يعني اللي حصلت لي في السودان. المراه مضطهده شديد جدا يعني اضطهاد شديد حتى في 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 في, في كل ولايات السودان حتى في الغرب في الشرق يعني المرأة مشكلة المرأة في العلوم التكنولوجيا كنا بنشتغل يعني عن حقوق المرأة والعنف ضد المرأة وحقوق الطفل أنا كنت يعني زولة نشيطة جدا وكنت بحب العمل الطوعي وبحب العمل الخيري وبحب يعني نشاط المرأة كنت دائما مع المرأة بكون واقفة تعرضت لي العنف اللفظي تعرضت للعنف الضرب يعني انا جوا راي بيتي خشوا وحرقوا حاجاتي كلها يعني كل شيء حرقوه. أنا حتى الآن أنا ما قادرة أنسى أصوات كلامهم معي وضربهم لي. أنا حتى الآن الكلام ده يعني في 2011 2010 و2011 حتى الآن أنا كأنه اللحظة يعني بيجيني صوتهم ما قادرة أنسى. في بشر بالصورة دي، الحاجة دي اللي ما زالت موجودة وما أفتكر إنها يوم من الأيامات الحاجة دي حتزيل من السودان. جيت أمريكا والحمد لله لقيت عون من الأخوان والأخوات الأمريكيين يقفوا معاي والله الحمد لله، ويعني ساعدوني كثير حتى ما وصلت للحتة دي. وأنا عندي لحد آخر قطرة في آخر يوم في عمري أنا حدافع عن المرأة، ما حخلي المرأة، دي أمنياتي. أواصل وأساعد المرأة تاخد حقوقها كامل. الخوف مشى من قلبي، بقيت ما بخاف لأنه فقدت كثير. مستقبل يعني أرجع تاني أدرس أتكلم عن المرأة، أعمل ندوات عن المرأة، أعمل برامج للمرأة والطفل والتعليم. بشعر بأمان الحمد لله، أتمنى إنه يعني أنا أمارس نشاطي وحاجاتي زي ما كنت الحمد لله. ويعني أنا طبعا بشكركم أنتم طبعا. أنا مما جيت أمريكا الحمد لله لقيت رعاية شديد جدا جدا، ولقيت عناية مع رب العالمين. يعني الحمد لله بشكر أي زول وقف معي في أمريكا من أخواني الأمريكان والأمريكانيات والدكتور كلهم والمحاميات بتاعتي، بشكرهم جدا جدا. كيري وكريستينا بشكرهم، يعني الناس دي كلها وقفت معاي وساعدتني، ويعني حسيت بالأمان والإطمئنان، قدرت أنوم، يعني قدرت أنوم. حييكم كثير 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 يعني من قلبي، بشكركم على الجائزة يعني منحت لي تمثال الحرية. وأتمنى إنه أنا دائما أكون عندي الحرية الكاملة ومنطلقة يعني. وبشكر منظمة البي سي يا المنظمة اللي أدتني الجائزة دي، بتمنى ليها دائما التوفيق. بشكره كثير خالص، وأنا سعيدة إنه أنا معاكم في استضافتكم، وبشكركم كثير يعني. بقول لكم سانكي أدا، وفي برنامجكم يعني اللي انتم بتقدموا لي والمساعده اللي انتم قدمتوها لي والوضع اللي انا هسه فيه ده الحمد لله وضع ايجابي شديد، تحسنت كثير الحمد لله. يا ريت تساعدوني، سعيده يعني. انا اصلا يعني كنت عشانه اتحاربت، وكنت عشانه اضطهدت، وكنت عشانه انضربت، وكنت عشانه يعني حصل لي كثير من تعسف. اتمنى الحاجات بتاعتي دي كلها يعني تبقى لي ذكرى.
A number of years ago, a wise man named Papa David stated that when we go to a funeral, we're not only crying for the person we just lost, but all of those we have lost before, all of those uncontrolled leave takings in our lives. 2020 and all of its stark cruelty has definitely reinforced this lesson, but we also hold on to the fact that mourning involves much more than sadness. The pictures you see, the dearly departed brothers and sisters in front of you, are incredible examples of resilience and courage. They all suffered horrendously in their home countries, but would not be defeated by the attempts to extinguish their humanity. They all managed to overcome the unspeakable and write improbable second acts to their lives that were both compelling and inspirational. I've come to understand that, painful as it might be, that the deaths of cherished friends and families are sometimes actually necessary for our growth. That many of the positive qualities that they possess now exist within us, but we would never recognize or utilize these skills while our predecessors were still among us. It may only be in their absence that we call up the strength that resides within us. We now have to look inside to find Khadijah's indomitable will, or perhaps Lamrana's sense of family, or his thirst for knowledge. We need to look inside for Bernadette's grace, or Sekou's resilient pride. We now need to look inside to find the joyful creativity that Muhammad Sharif Koyate shared with all of us. In life, they show us the way. In death, they free us to become the people we have the capacity to become.
Bellevue NYU Program for Survivors of Torture. We appreciate your support. On behalf of Casa Montequilla, we love you. We'll see you soon tonight.
I hope you saw the smile on Muhammad Sharif Koyate's face. I hope you felt that joy. And again, I hope that that's something that we carry with us at the moments we need it. Like now, as I've mentioned, we are at an inflection point. We're at a crossroads, and you know, it can be a matter of moments, but sometimes a moment can be under such intense pressure, it becomes a crucible, and the decisions we make, the actions we take, can resonate across generations. I look at my own example, and my family is descended from slaves on both sides, in the Caribbean and here in the United States. And I think about my ancestors, I think about their ability to survive, what they endured from capture, through the Middle Passage, through seasoning, through lifelong servitude, being born into slavery with no idea that before you die, anything would change. They didn't call it systemic racism back then. It was just the way things were. But somehow, in that hopeless situation, they managed to hold on to hope. They taught their children that they were valued so that we could understand that we were valuable. And generations went through like that. And sometimes I wonder if those ancestors can see me now. At night, when I want to say thank you and I want to say my prayers, I don't even know their names. I fantasize about what I would say when I meet them, how I would express the appreciation. I may not know their names, but I know Amal's name. I know Joseph's name and thousands of others who are making that same type of sacrifice with their lives. I sometimes refer to them as the crossroads generation, because with their courage, their persistence, their willingness to live their lives for something so much larger than them, not just for their children, but their children's children and their children and their children, to live a free life where they can aspire to their deepest and most profound dreams. Those people might not know Joseph's name or Amal's name. But they'll be appreciative and they will be the beneficiaries of their strength and their fortitude. We are privileged to be able to stand at the crossroads with these survivors, and we walk arm in arm with them. And when they are feeling overwhelmed, when the frustration is so great, when they are feeling pain and they want to give up and they look to us, we can't make promises that we can't keep, but as Hala mentioned in her poem, we can stand with our back straight and our chins up with the confidence that things will get better. And part of the reason that we're able to do that when we walk arm in arm with them is because we were always and constantly locked arm in arm with you as well. We know that we're not alone. We know that there is a community, that we are facing the challenges of this historic moment together. So I want you to be well. We want you to be safe, but don't be afraid of getting into necessary trouble, as the great Representative John Lewis would say. We want you to be blessed and appreciative, but also understand that you are appreciated. Another thing I should say is you might want to vote. Think about voting not so much as a right or even as a responsibility, but think about it as a privilege. Think about some of the people you have met tonight who would love to have that opportunity, but there have been purposeful efforts to delay them or deny them. Even if you weren't thinking of voting for yourself, vote with them in mind. Be that voice for the voiceless. And when we stand together again at that crossroads, know that we are proud to stand with you, to stand with them, and we come together as one family. Again, my name is Hawthorne Smith, and on behalf of the Bellevue Program for Survivors of Torture, we want to thank you and wish you good night.